Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
And a very warm welcome to St. James the Great in Chapelthorpe. And for those also watching from their own homes today, either through Facebook or YouTube, you are more than welcome to join us in this service of praise and worship. Just to let you know of some slight changes in the service, Sandra here will be supporting Catherine with some of the sub responses, but they're not for you to join in, just for Catherine and Sandra to sing. Unfortunately, at this time there is no singing in the congregation still permitted. Okay. So let us still our hearts and minds in the presence of God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in Jesus' life, to glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, Heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, Holy Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
And we continue to stand for the collect. Almighty God, who called your church to bear witness that you were in Christ reconciling the world to yourself, help us to proclaim the good news of your love, that all who hear it may be drawn to you, through him who has lifted up on high the cross, and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
The first reading is from the book of Ezekiel. The word of the Lord came to me, So you, mortal, I have made a sentinel of the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked ones, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to all the wicked to turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in their iniquity, but their blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from their ways, and they do not turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in their iniquity, but you will save your life. Now, you mortal, say to the house of Israel, thus you have said, our transgressions and our sins weigh upon us, and we waste away because of them. How then can we live? Say to them, as I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from their ways and live. Turn back from your evil ways, for why will you die, O house of Israel? This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 119, verses 33 to 40, and there is a refrain after verses 36 and 40. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I shall keep it to the end. Give me understanding, and I shall keep your law. I shall keep it with my whole heart. Lead me in the path of your commandments, for therein is my delight. Incline my heart to your testimonies, and not to unjust gain.
My delight shall be in your commandments.
Turn away my eyes, lest they gaze on vanities, or give me life in your ways. Confirm to your servant your promise, which stands for all who fear you. Turn away the reproach which I dread, because your judgments are good. Behold, I long for your commandments. In your righteousness, give me life.
My delight shall be in your commandments.
The epistle reading is taken from Romans, chapter 13, verses 8 to 14. Owe no one anything, except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word: love your neighbour as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbour. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone, the day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armour of light. Let us live honourably as in the day, not in revelling and drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarrelling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
to his disciples. If a member of the church sins against you, go and point out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you, so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly, I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there among them. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May it be given to me to speak in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. I want to take you back to the early days of the railways. If you'll both indulge me and forgive me for playing to the typical stereotype of a steam train-loving cleric. And I specifically want to take you back to the railway lines around Blackburn and Burnley, where in those days there were a multiplicity of companies plying and vying for their trade. One of these companies was called the Lancashire and Yorkshire Railway, and they ran mainline services out of Manchester and across the region. One of their rivals, the smaller East Lancashire Railway, gained parliamentary approval to build a new line that would cross the Lancashire and Yorkshire at two places, Clifton Junction and Blackburn. Now, it was not unusual for companies' lines to cross each other, nor for trains from one company to use stretches of another company's line. Indeed, the charges levied on such activity served to increase the relevant company's profits, and the situation was usually mutually beneficial. However, in the case of these two companies, such charitable dealings were woefully lacking, because not long after the East Lancashire began to run non-stop services over the Lancashire and Yorkshire's lines, they were involved in a dispute. I won't go into the details, but suffice to say that the Lancashire and Yorkshire, distrusting their rivals, decided that all trains would be halted at Clifton Junction. And so, the next time one of the East Lancashire Railway's trains attempted to run straight through the station, they were confronted by an engineering train that had deliberately blocked the line. Thus followed a rather farcical and prolonged pushing competition between the two trains, who each attempted to push each other out of the way. And the police were eventually called to break the stalemate. The local journalists had a field day. Now, after the ensuing disruption, you might be forgiven for thinking that these two railway companies soon came to a slightly more civil line-sharing agreement, but you'd be wrong. Sometime later, when the Lancashire and Yorkshire built a line that passed through the East Lancashire Railway's Blackburn station, it was the turn of their competitors to block the line. The first train to run, bedecked with patriotic bunting and a rousing brass band, was brought to a juddering halt by a rake of immobile ballast wagons. As the dispute escalated, 200 rough-looking navvies turned up, carrying pickaxes. Threats were issued, and the police again called. What the passengers on the trains, which were by now backing up in all directions, made of all this, history does not record. The disputes between these two railway companies spilled into the public domain, thus damaging their reputations. And yet, given that they were later to merge into a single company, they could have saved considerable face if they had only dealt with everything behind closed doors. What this slightly absurd tale demonstrates is that disputes and disagreements amongst what are essentially the members of the same family are better dealt with quietly and respectfully. Airing one's dirty washing in public, as it were, merely serves to increase divisions, create bitterness, and damage reputations. Jesus' instructions to the disciples that his followers should sort out disagreements amongst themselves goes beyond the need to mitigate reputational damage. His directive makes clear that God's power to reprove and forgive sinners is vested in the body of the church. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven, he says. It is more Christian to quietly seek redress from one who has done wrong. It is more honest, more Christ-like, to sort things out face to face, sister to brother, than to do so in the public domain. Much more than this, however, is the unique foundation upon which the church is built: love. If we say that we love God, then we must also love our neighbour. One follows on from the other. They are not mutually exclusive. In Mark's Gospel, Jesus makes the link even more explicit when he says that there is no other commandment greater than these. For St. Paul, love is indeed the fulfilling of the law. It is what guides the moral and ethical basis of the church. Love is not something that can be constrained or earned. It cannot be given conditionally or reluctantly. Love originates in and through God, and it embodies all of Christ's teaching to us. For both Paul and Jesus, the interpersonal relationships within the Christian community are to be based on the fact that love does no wrong to a neighbour. Indeed, that love listens to its neighbour and takes their words into account. Therefore, to love our neighbour means allowing each member of the church the opportunity to repent and be reconciled. It means giving the sinner every chance to return to the fold. Only when all else has failed and every avenue of hope explored can the painful decision be made to let them go. Loving our brothers and sisters in this way means that we don't drag our disputes with them into the secular world. To love our neighbour is to protect them from the shame of public recrimination. It is all about the restoration of a damaged relationship, rather than justice, whatever the cost. The command to love your neighbour as you would wish to be loved, and as God loves you, is as true today as it ever was. When so much of human life in the 21st century is full of squabbles and selfish desires, permeated by a culture of individualism that puts self first and others last, it is all the more important to look out for our neighbour and to show them the same respect, care and compassion that God shows to us. As our erstwhile railway companies found out, when someone hurts us, when someone does wrong, it is all too easy to become belligerent and push back against them, block them and even gang up against them. But we should always choose the difficult path, the one that leads to dialogue, conversation and, God willing, a way forward that ends in reconciliation. At the height of the lockdown, this country experienced an outpouring of love for those who were facing hardship and loss. But look around us now. There is as much suffering in the world as there ever was, and yet we seem to have moved on. Refugees and migrants are treated with disdain even before their stories have been heard. Those struggling to make ends meet and needing state assistance to put food on the table are made to feel shame. Parents and workers, rightly anxious about the safety of the resumption of normal life, are condemned as scaremongers without their fears being taken seriously. Whatever we may personally feel about these or any other news item, we are commended and commanded to consider the human side of all this. Jesus asks us to listen to each other, talk with each other, love one another, to give others the same respect and voice as we would expect ourselves. And this is as important for our worldly neighbours as it is with our fellow Christians. So next time you fall out with a brother or sister in Christ, or whenever you see someone in the street or on the news who has done or said something you find questionable, remember Jesus' commandment. Love one another, because love is the very ground of our being. Where two or three are gathered, I am there, says the Lord. Amen.
We now stand to say the Nicene Creed.
We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for
intercessory response for our intercessions is, Lord, hear us. Lord, graciously hear us. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, you promised through your Son, Jesus Christ, to hear us when we pray in faith. And we pray to you, our Father. We pray for all who teach the faith and pass it on by example. For all who witness with humility and quietness to what they believe, and for each in their vocation and ministry, so that we will witness to you through whom we are. We pray for our Wakefield area bishop, Tony Robinson, and for our other area bishops in the Diocese of Leeds, Toby Howe, Dr. Helen Hartley, and Jonathan Gibbs, and for our diocesan bishop, Nicholas Baines. We pray for our parish clergy, Kevin and Catherine, and give thanks for all that they do for the parishes of St. James Chapelford and St. Peter's Woolley with West Breton. And let us give thanks also and pray for the continuing ministry of John and Jill, our lay readers. In the Church's calendar of prayer, we pray for Iceni Secondary School in Serengeti region, in our Link Diocese of Tanzania, and the coordinator there, Aileen Metzen. Lord, make us mindful of the needs of others, and especially for those church members who are not able to be with us today. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Let us pray for all the world and the nations. We pray, Lord, that you will bless this nation and our national life. We pray for those who seek to enrich our lives by their actions and example, and for those who have difficult decisions to make. Pray for those in positions of power and authority. For all in society who are excluded and in poverty. We pray for justice, for peace in our communities. Let us pray for the suffering world and its people, for the ever-increasing number of people who are motivated to act against the interests of human dignity, for those who suffer through the actions of others. Closer to home, we pray for our own communities in different towns and cities, where there is increasing discord, division, and poverty. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Father, we give you thanks for all that is done for us, the love which you give to us through the actions and care of others. We pray for families with worries and problems, for those who care for the ill and infirm, for families where there is disharmony, that they may find rest and peace. Pray for all who take care of children in our schools, for parents with young families and the challenges they face. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer, in body, mind, or spirit. May your comfort and consolation soothe those who are afraid or are in great pain. And we pray for those we know in our own parish. For Julia Flack, Roger Kay, Jay Woodcock, and the Reverend Alan Shaw. Lord, hear us.
Lord, hear us.
And hear also, as we remember those who have died in the faith of Christ, remembering G. Joan Simpson and Molly Firth. And also let us remember those whose anniversaries fall at this time, Dennis Poucher and Amy Greaves. And may all those who have passed into eternity be welcomed into your heavenly kingdom to live with you forever. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And we now stand for the peace. And observing the current guidelines, we will share the peace if in a family bubble in the normal way, but if you're not in a family bubble, by turning and facing the people in the other pews and raising your hand or nodding your head. You can even smile, though they won't see it because you've got your face mask on. But there may be a twinkle in the eye. Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation.
Blessed be God forever.
Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness, and according to your holy will. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." So, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. James and St. Peter and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Jesus, Lamb of God, have mercy on us. Jesus, heir of our sins, have mercy on us. Jesus, Redeemer of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed. I invite our brothers and sisters who are watching this service in their own homes to now say the words of spiritual communion. You will now be guided by the sight persons to receive communion.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God, our Creator, you feed your children with true manna, the living bread from heaven. Let this holy food sustain us through our earthly pilgrimage, until we come to that place where hunger and thirst are no more. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you and those whom you love, now and forever. Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Does.